Ward 3 Neighborhood Outreach, this is our second one that we're doing. We did one in June 2016. And since then, we've gone and done neighborhood outreach in every one of the 5 wards. We're starting on our second group of them. We have another one that we'll probably do in the fall. We'll get to all of them within the next 12 months. So they've been very successful. We've had great feedback, so we're going to continue to do them as long as they still work. We're the Citywide Neighborhood Committee, and we put these on, and I just wanted to introduce, I'm Kathy Bergeron, I'm the chair. Chase Hageman is the vice chair, he's not here tonight. Paul Mantle is back taking sign-ins. Larry Cataldo is also not here. Kelly Weinstein, Kathleen Bodick. Rick Beckstead is on our panel, and he's also on our committee, and Cliff Lazenby. So the Citywide Neighborhood Committee, we really work to help advocate for the neighborhoods. And this is part of what we feel really, really works, because you get to get your issues right out to the people that can help and answer questions. Some of the initiatives that we've had in the past that have worked, that we've been working on, is we worked with the city to educate residents on how the capital improvement plan works, how it goes through the process, the budgeting. We've had a legislative forum at the library where all Portsmouth state legislators came and taught us how a bill would go through, how we can contact them, how we can be an advocate for our city. We also have had talked to the mayor about city council liaisons, and the last council there was a liaison for each ward, which was something new. We haven't done anything with that this term, but we'll talk about that. National Night Out, 15 to 20 neighborhoods participate in National Night Out every year. That's been going on for probably 20 years, about maybe. And that's with the police department that we work with them to put that on. We have helped advocate on transportation, parking, land use, and then we hold these neighborhood outreach forums. If anybody is interested in coming to our meetings, next meeting is Wednesday, June 20th. Then National Night Out for this summer is Tuesday, August 7th. And then the other outreach forums are all tentative dates, but we will publish them. They'll be on the city website. We'll put them out on Nextdoor, on our Facebook page. We'll get everything out. So I'll introduce the panel. Most of you know everybody. We have Peter Rice from Public Works, Nancy Colbert Puff, Deputy City Manager, Mayor Jack Blaylock, Rick Beckstead, City Council, Chief Achilles, and Captain Workoff. So what I'm going to do is start out, and I'm going to start with you, Captain Workoff, and you can kind of give a little bit of information on what's going on with the state of the police department.
Sure.
And then we'll go from there. We'll probably have everybody talk a little bit. Peter will do his public works presentation, and then you can do questions and answers. I'm also going to have Peter Somsich is here, and he has a little bit he can say on sound barriers and where we are with that. So, go ahead.
Thank you. I appreciate you having me here tonight. Just a few points I want to go over with you folks to give you an idea of what we're looking at the police department, specifically over the last year and what we've been dealing with. Just so that you're aware, we are going through the CALEA process, which is the national accreditation process that incorporates the national best practices standards, and that's something we're still trying to achieve. At this point, we're about 99% compliant with our standing operating procedures. Right now, we're in the phase of collecting what we call proofs for this CALEA accreditation process. That's basically what backs up and tells the public this is what we're doing because we say we're doing this. And again, this has been done through the tireless work of our accreditation manager, Jackie Burnett, and Lieutenant Darren Sargent. And we continue to push through this to make full accreditation. Traffic enforcement has been the major issue here in the city. It's our number one complaint that we get on a regular basis. It's the number one quality of life issue that we have here in our city. I don't think I need to explain that to you. I think we all know, we've all felt it. But just to give you an idea of where we're at with traffic enforcement, excuse me, back in 2016, as a department, we stopped about 7,743 cars, which may seem like a lot. But in essence, last year, this past year, in 2017, we stopped 12,671 cars. So we've almost doubled our efforts in the past year. Kind of gives you an idea of where our head is at and what we're trying to accomplish. In 2016, we ended up writing 383 citations, or motor vehicle summonses. This past year, we've written 1,671. So, you know, by four times as many tickets are going out there to the public. Also, too, our calls for service have increased by about 11,000 calls for service from 16 to 17. And that includes all the work that the officers are doing, building checks, motor vehicle stops. So you can see we're awfully busy here for just a city of 21,500 sleeping population. As far as enforcement, just the last part of enforcement I just want to touch on is the motorcycle noise enforcement. We've purchased the equipment to do motorcycle noise enforcement. We have two officers who are going to be trained at the beginning of May in order to accomplish this task. And right now we're looking to hold one or two motorcycle safety seminars, which includes to show the public how we measure noise and also the safety issues that are involved with riding motorcycles. The opiate issue that we deal with in the city, we continue with that fight. We're collaborating with the DEA and the FBI, putting Portsmouth first and working on Portsmouth cases. We also use our high-intensity drug enforcement team to go after these types of crimes to assist in drug operations as they pertain to Portsmouth. A lot of questions about the schools as well lately. Kind of give you an idea where we're at with the schools. The staff at all three elementary schools to date, as of I think this past Friday, have all been trained in ALICE. ALICE is an active shooter response training, and the acronym stands for Alert, Lockdown, Inform, Counter, and Evacuate. So all the staff has been trained on how to handle an active shooter situation. Staff and students at Portsmouth Middle School and the high school have been trained in ALICE as well. And as of tomorrow, all sworn officers of our police department will have been trained in ALERT. And ALERT is the Advanced Law Enforcement Rapid Response Training. And that's how we respond to an active shooter situation in a school, in a business. So all of us have been trained on that. I just finished it up just this past week as well. And also, too, we do the CRAZE training, which is the Citizen Response to Active Shooter event. To date, we have put it about 30 to 35 trainings through businesses throughout the city, and we continue to do so on a regular basis. As a matter of fact, the City Hall employees are going to be trained on CRAZE training this Friday. So we continue to do that as well. So that's where we stand in the police department to date.
Okay, so Chief Achilles.
Well, good evening, everybody. I had a long commute from Elwin Park, so apologize. I met a number of you before, and I've done these quite a number of times, but it's always important to relay that first and foremost, I'm your fire chief. I work for your fire department. Sometimes they think it's mine. Recently, somebody thought I got a boat. And I can assure you, I do not have a boat ordered that's going to go in my driveway or I'll be using for fishing. But I do want to mention the support we received this past week. I know there's a lot of questions about that, and I think in the paper it's gone back and forth a little bit. But again, I appreciate the support of the council members and the mayor that were here on that evening. And it really, I think, is what's best for the community. And that's really the goal. A lot of things we do are focused on the community, much like the police department and public works department. One being a resident, one, this is where my kids grew up, this is where my wife works. Again, I live in Elwin Park, so the idea is that, you know, I go to everything and be everywhere just like everybody else, and I want it to be safe, and I have some expectations when I go downtown that it's safe, when I go into a school, a restaurant. I actually stayed in a hotel a little while ago downtown, try it out. Your department is, especially for Ward 3, is kind of split because you have two fire stations out of the three that cover you. One is out at Pease that often is thought of as, well, it's the Pease Tradeport Firehouse. And it is. There's a lot of workers out there that, and that's growing, as you've been hearing. But we also support Panaway Manor, Gosling from that station, and that is our first coming into the downtown and supporting the other response areas. And the other firehouse that you have is Station 2, right down there at the corner of Ocean Lafayette, and that protects quite a big area also. Our other station is downtown, and that's where a majority of our calls are, but the way the city is designed, all the three stations are geographically located so that on average it only takes us about 8 minutes to get to your problem. And that is one of our goals to do, barring weather or what we're increasingly seeing is higher demands for requests for services. So our fire trucks and ambulances are moving all throughout the city. So the Station 2 firehouse, you may say, well, where are they? And they might be downtown backing up a call that happened down there and vice versa with the station out at Peace. So that's something we will be presenting to the community here coming up in our budget of, you know, how do we respond? And the fire department doesn't set policy as far as our development and economic growth, but we have to respond to it. So you'll be hearing more about that. We have 60 people on the department, men and women, and they're pretty highly dedicated to respond. And at any point in time, if you ever see them on the street or Market Basket or downtown, or please talk to them. We do National Night Out, gives you an opportunity, and we rather deal with people not in a 911 critical incident. We rather just have that conversation, so please reach out. And the two firehouses, the P station is just finishing a renovation to make it a little more modernized. It was a 50s vintage aircraft, Air Force station. It's updated, and again, appreciate the support of the councils in the past and the city manager in moving that forward. But please stop in and your station down at Ocean Lafayette. It's a great place to, you know, if you have grandchildren, kids, anytime, please go in there. There's a couple initiatives that I'd like to dovetail onto what the captain was talking about. We do have a rescue vehicle coming to the city. It's almost completed, but that will support some of our unique rescues that we have. Often people forget, but motor vehicle accidents, people getting entrapped, some industrial accidents, we need some more resources and a bigger toolbox often to help resolve that problem. There was an unfortunate accident with Public Works on Lang Road a couple of years ago, and something like that would support, you know, that kind of complicated technical extrication. So you may see that we hope to have that in the city in the next month or so. So we'll announce that's coming out, and you're more than welcome to see that. That will be out at Station 3 out at Pease. It's just going to fit, and it's a great location. The other one is the, unfortunately, we have to not just deal with fires and medical emergencies and traumatic injuries and things in the water, but unfortunately, we're having to deal more and more with violence in the workplace, violence in schools, and there's an expectation that instead of the medical providers and fire departments staying outside, we can go inside and support police once they secure areas for us to work and increase survivability from injuries. And unfortunately, this has happened all over the country, not just in schools, but in workplaces and on streets. So we received a grant. We submitted for a grant for ballistic protective equipment. We're not going to carry firearms, but the idea is that our firefighters and paramedics can work with the police and go in with them and be safe and start providing care. So that's an initiative. We've had a great partnership with our PD on this, but it's unfortunate we have to, in this day and age, we have to do that. But that's something we're out doing. The last thing I'll leave you with is on the website, city's website, fire department, under resources, we have a couple documents, and ones are self-assessment we did in 2015. We're kind of using that as our strategic plan. So if you wonder what does the fire department do, it's up to date up to 2015. Kind of gives you an idea of historically what we do, what it costs the community for fire protection, how we deploy, all those things. I'm not saying it's an exciting read, but it will give you information. The next one is our standard of cover document, and this is much in line with what accreditation does. We're using that model from a fire side of it, is why do we deploy what we do? What are our benchmarks? So often people say, well, why is a fire truck going with an ambulance to my house or my neighbor's house for something? And why do you need two engines and a ladder to go to a business for a problem? They're all benchmarked and best practices based on national standards. So we create that document of what level of service should you expect, and then why do we deploy what we deploy? That's our standard cover. And the last document is our history of the department. It's up to date. I've been working on this for a while. So if you wanted to know, you know, what's the history of the fire department? What's the history of some of the unique incidents in the city, good and bad? We've collected all those by date. So it gives you a snippet of each year. It's not every single thing that happened every year. Last year was very busy for us. We had a large fire downtown. That's in there. But often people will read this and, oh, I didn't know this happened in my neighborhood. I didn't know there was a plane crash ever in Portsmouth, or why. Some of the other interesting things are how many people we had on the department, when was the first full-time person. So those are three documents. And then if afterwards you have any questions, please, I'll answer anything. But even offline, if you want to just talk, I can give you my cell phone number if you have any questions about what we do, why we do things, or any feedback.
I'm going to have Peter. Do you want to do your public works?
Sure, unless
now?
The mayor. Or
yeah,
else
I didn't know if you guys want
to.
We can.
Say,
it's pretty casual. So, do you have anything that you guys want to bring up now, or do you want to wait till after the?
I would just mention that we've got some pretty exciting city projects ongoing and about to happen. Mm-hmm. One, our long-awaited parking garage downtown is going to be finished sometime in October, hopefully by middle to late October. And I find that very exciting. A lot of people, I think, will there'll be a lot of advantage to having that. The second one is our master plan for Prescott Park. You know, we should pretty soon start seeing some improvements down there and to our beautiful. It's already a beautiful park. We're just enhancing it and bringing it up to the current times and its usage. And obviously, with the goal that it be nice and complete by the 400th anniversary of 2023, which is another exciting event here in Portsmouth. And thirdly, I would say is the process we've been conducting on the McIntyre Building. From all appearances, that's going to be an exciting part of downtown. Once we acquire the property and are able to put our stamp on it, I think people are going to be thrilled. It's just going to be, not that Portsmouth isn't already an exciting place to be. Most of you here tonight know, you know, that's the go-to place. Just go downtown and see what's going on. It'll be just one more area. So I'm very excited about those things and hope that other people mm-hmm. can be supportive of those and get involved.
Rick or Nancy, any comments you'd like? No?
I don't have too much to add. I'm here on behalf of John Bohanko, the city manager, so I'm happy to answer any questions you may have or bring back any concerns to City Hall. It is a very, very busy period of time in terms of the municipal year right now, because in just a week, the city manager will have a final proposed budget prepared, and then he'll transmit that to the City Council, and the City Council will spend the next several weeks reviewing the details of next year's budget. It also happens to be the kickoff of many construction projects. I know the building department right now is just flat out with the number of applications it's seeing and the inspections process, and Peter's going to talk a lot about the public works projects that are going on right now.
Okay. All right. And Peter?
Yeah.
There you go.
Thank you, Kathy. And I want to just express my appreciation for the Citywide Neighborhood Groups putting these together. I think it's a great opportunity to have dialogue with everybody. And you know, we've done, this is the first, we're coming back around from the second time around, and it's good for me to see and go through what we've done and what we haven't done so that we can keep focused on what's important to the various groups of the city. As you guys know, Ward 3 is the biggest ward in the city. It goes from, I don't know if you can see if it's washed out or not. Yeah.
It's kind of. Outlined in yellow. We'll see Ward 3.
Yeah. One of those lights we're going
to. With marketing.
Yeah, so I'm.
That's
So that doesn't go too well. On my figure, it looks great. But it's what it, yeah, it shows Ward 3 is pretty much the full length of the city, the west side of the city, which divides from Route 1 over. And there's a number of projects where you may not realize are in your ward, but they are. First, just a brief talk on public outreach, what we're doing on that. Then we'll talk about current and pending projects and then traffic calming, because I know that's something that's of concern to folks. The city has a number of avenues of doing outreach, and one of the ways that we get input is the Click and Fix program. I just wanted to remind people that it's out there. You can access it via your mobile phone or through the city's website. It's a good way of accessing our work order system and directly getting stuff to our foremen who actually do the work instead of calling it in through the website and it going a slow route to getting to the place where it needs to get. In addition, we've had the city's completed a recent update to its website. If you haven't gone to the city's website in the last 6 months, please do. It's really, the format is much more accessible. There's an incredible amount of information. As the chief said, he's got his stuff on there. The police have really good information on there, and we have a wealth of information. If you're interested in the wastewater plant, there's a ton of stuff there. If you're interested in the water quality issues that have been in the news lately, there's a ton of stuff there associated with that. And there's really, it's a real wealth of information that, staff spends a lot of time putting the information out there. So you all can have access to it, and we're very proud of that. Then finally, we're following the inspection department's lead with getting a lot of our permits online so that residents don't have to come in. They can actually do it online, and that's something that we think is a great way to make it more accessible for folks. Some of the projects that have been completed since we last met and that are near completion or in construction, Woodlawn Circle Drainage, there was a section of drainage in that area that was replaced. Gosling Road pedestrian bicycle improvements was completed. The Banfield Road Master Plan was completed, even though there's a lot of it that's not implemented. The plan is in place, and like many plans, they are a template for us to move forward with. The Woodbury Avenue Traffic Signal Coordination Project has just been awarded, and that should be something that you'll be seeing work on in the near term. And Barbary Lane Railroad Crossing, where that is not a city project directly, we are involved in it, and they're going to be replacing the railroad crossing there, and the gas company will be replacing the gas line from Islington all the way down to their station at the end of Barbary Lane. Some of the projects that are pending include the Stump Dump, multi-use field, which is the old Stump Dump, it's the Route 33. We recently received bids, and we'll be working with the city manager and the mayor to bring that forward to city council for consideration. The Doble Center is coming close to being transferred to the city, and once that's transferred, we'll be starting work on creating a center there for seniors. The Sound Barrier projects, Councilor Somsich or Representative Somsich could speak more to afterwards, but we've been working with the DOT who've created enabling a policy to allow for that to happen independent of large projects, highway projects, which is exciting. But the problem with that is that they require the city to have ordinances in place for sound sound barriers as part of their construction ordinances, and that's something our planning department is working on, and Representative Somsich has been in the lead to push for funding and for studies to show, and I'm sure he'll be able to speak further to that. The Hampton Branch Rail Trail project is in limbo with the DOT and Pan Am. We're hoping that breaks free so we can move forward with that program. That's going to be a very exciting project. The Banfield Road Culvert Project, which is the first step in the implementation of the master plan of Banfield Road, has been stalled due to permitting challenges as well as easement issues. We recently are in the process of, we scheduled the purchase and sale of a piece of property, which is important for easements to get the project moving forward. And we believe the DES will be issuing our permits. So our hope is that we can move this forward this fall with the start of that. We can continue to move those projects forward. The Peverly Hill Road projects in what they call preliminary design. This project has been agonizingly slow. The funding mechanism is through the state, and their state process has been start and stop, but we now have a pretty firm schedule from the state, and they've been working closely with us. I'll speak a little bit more on Beverly Hill in a second. I have a couple slides that get into greater depth. The Route 1 projects are both DOT projects that we'll be involved with them with. They're in the process of selecting consultant, and that's the design of that project should be moving forward hopefully in the next year to get that to fruition. The Long Meadow Road extension is a change of the Lang Road intersection, which will provide an alternative left turn southbound option for folks. It'll be at the Ocean Road signalized intersection, and this will be a great safety improvement getting down Route 1 from that area. The Kate Street Bridge project is identified, and we're hoping to see some movement on the Kate Street connector, which would be a connection from, instead of having to go all the way up to Cottage Street, that would be a direct connection to the Route 1 bypass at Borthwick Avenue, which would help alleviate truck traffic in the Bartlett Street area, and that's something that we feel would be very beneficial to the residents. The New Franklin and Woodbury corridor upgrades are slated to move forward next fall, once we have secured monies in July, with the intent to get a final design in the fall, and we're hoping to have it in place for when the Woodbury Avenue Bridge is taken out of service, that we can do the work in conjunction with the DOT project there. And then finally, we have Pease Roadways, which are ongoing. As you know, Pease is part of our responsibility for maintaining the roads. As I said, the Beverly Hill project has been moving along at a slow rate, but we have seen some positive improvement. Just recently, we were given authorization to do the preliminary design from DOT. The design process takes about a year, and then the right-of-way impacts are that we have some drainage impacts, and there's a number of right-of-ways that we need to secure to be able to complete the project. And that is anticipated to take about a year. With the design completed, and we're looking to bid the project in January of 2020, with construction to begin in April. The cross section of the roadway will have a bike path, pedestrian path on the west side, which is the Het Farm side of the, and then there'll be a sidewalk on the other side. So it'll be a vast improvement from where it's at now, and I understand people's frustration relative to the speed at which it's getting completed, but we do see movement forward on that. The next item I'd like to just talk briefly about is traffic calming. People often ask, you know, can we have stop signs? Can we have narrow the roads? Can we do things to put speed bumps? And they don't understand the process. So what we've been doing is working with the planning department and the Parking, Traffic, and Safety Committee. We've created a more formal process with which residents can start submit a request, and that starts a formal evaluation. And it really starts with just notifying my parking engineer, Eric Eby, of an issue, and then he starts the collection process. He does speed monitoring, traffic counts, and studies the traffic. And then out of that effort, there are two responses. One is a non-infrastructure type project, which is signage and painting, and it's a relatively easy thing to do. And then the other is a more significant or capital intensive, which is actual changes to the infrastructure, roadway configuration. And there's a number of things that you can do. On the non-infrastructures, it's really signs and speed indicators and enforcement and parking management, because parking on the streets actually helps calm traffic because it narrows the visual roadway width. And then there's a whole plethora of items that you can do, ranging from speed bumps and speed humps and all sorts of different types of things. And I'll use an example of the Echo Avenue area, which is in your ward. The Echo Ave folks requested a closing off of the street because there's a lot of through traffic coming in off the Route 16. So the first step was to collect the data We did traffic counts, which all these numbers here are showing the volume of traffic in the area, so that we can assess what types of change, if we shut that off, where would that traffic go? And Eric Eby, the transportation engineer, has been working on that. We had a public meeting, got some really good input, and we're moving forward with recommendations at two locations. One would be to put a barricade for Echo Avenue to restrict traffic coming in off of 16, and the other is down at Farm Lane, making it one way onto the Route 16 and do not enter coming out. That isolates the truck traffic and through traffic and minimizes the impacts there. So that's just kind of an example of, you know, the request came in, we evaluated it, and then we came up with options, and we're looking forward to putting some of these in place to try it out and to see how it works. And that's the extent of this presentation.
Does anybody have any questions for Peter to start, or? Yep.
Hi, Kelly.
Hi. Well, it's kind of you and we've had all the traffic studies and everything done on Banfield Road.
Kelly, sorry, would you mind using the mic just so that
everyone can hear me?
I just want to have the recording catch it. There's many people that want
for the people at home that are watching.
Yes. For the viewing audience.
And all come.
On Banfield Road, we've done all the traffic studies. Mm-hmm. Everything that we've need to have done already over the past year or two. So I really think we need a traffic calm. We're at the point where we could pull the data and get the traffic calming, because we still need it. And the perfect spot for the traffic calming would be at the railroad tracks that aren't there, because that was always a traffic calming area. It has not improved whatsoever over that way at all. We've had a lot of traffic enforcement over that way since Chief Mara and Chief Mercer have come in. However, the police seem to be hanging out at Richie's on Sunday afternoon again, down at that where there isn't hardly any traffic. Mm-hmm. We need to get, you know, more policing down in our area, and that goes with all the growth that has happened in our area. We need increase in services. You guys need more manpower or women power. You need more bodies, or you're gonna have more overtime. More bodies will create less overtime. But you do need a bigger workforce, especially in our area, because everything seems to be focused in the downtown area and we're secondary. I know you're in my area, so you're gonna get there close. You guys aren't in my area, so I know it takes you longer to get to me, and I don't think it's fair because I'm paying my taxes as well. Nothing against you. I will be speaking at the budget meeting. And there was another thing. Oh, can you, I know I'm supposed to do the click and fix, and I'm not good at it. The beavers have clogged up the culvert again.
Okay.
So, I don't want to plug Eric. So if you could get that fixed.
Yep.
But I just, you know, thank you for your services. I really appreciate it. But again, I think we're lost in the shuffle. Here's Rick and Cliff from our area. It would be nice to see the other city councilors from the rest of the city council here representing us versus these guys representing us, so that they can see our concerns. They have no idea what happens at our end of town, what goes on. We have a new 94 apartment building where they have guest grills outside there. And we have a lot more construction out there. And the other question was, is where is the Route 1 DOT traffic light possibility at West Road, which they're talking about, because they're talking about that Long Meadow at Lang, so they'd create that light at Ocean Road and at Lang, and they would go Long Meadow around the backside of the credit union, cut off Lang Road. So where is it in the plan, which is in the plan, the CIP for the, I forget what you call it, the Rockingham Planning Commission, for the 10-year plan that to put a light at the West Road. And because they're doing construction at the church, so that's changing something, so that should automatically get us in line to have that upgraded, to have that done.
Sure. So as you know, as you know, that section of Route 1 is a state road.
I know it's a state road, but we're changing something on the state road.
We are not changing something. The developer is doing that. The state is responsible for that area, and that they are aware of this request. They are actually in the process of hiring a consultant to start what they're calling the road widening project.
Right.
So it'd be a really good, I would encourage everybody to weigh in on that process, because once they've got it in their mindset that they want to make a much wider Route 1, and it's going to have a material impact in terms of the way that feels, and it's not necessarily the same as just putting a traffic signal in.
I understand.
So where they're at right now is it's in the DOT's court. We are involved with it. We actually just met with them last week to reinforce our concerns relative to Route 1. And we will continue to be involved in that, and there'll be public meetings associated with that. So what I encourage you to do is reach out, you know, pay attention to the DOT stuff, and there'll be, when the meetings...
Oh, I do.
And when the meeting occurs, you know, be vocal on it to make sure that you get heard. They, you know, they've been informed of that request, that there's a traffic signal there, and it may be on the Rockingham planning, but that doesn't mean DOT...
It's been on there forever.
I know, but it doesn't mean DOT is going to buy into it. They say, yeah, that's great, you identified it. But when they look at it, they look at it, and you've heard Eric Eby talk about warrants, mm-hmm. and if it's warranted or not. They look at it and they determine whether it's warranted or not, and based on their criteria, they are the arbiters of whether a traffic signal goes in or not.
We don't want them to be another water country where they get away with not doing what they were supposed to be doing with the DOT. So in other words...
You're talking about the condo?
No, the water country with not having a permitted driveway, mm-hmm. and they were supposed to, and if had that had happened, the configuration would have been changed and Water Country would have probably had to change something. Instead, it was allowed to be able to put off on the side street. I won't go down that road. But I don't want to see the same thing kind of happen at the church where, you know, this is a perfect opportunity for them, you know, and the DOT and for the developer, you know, to have that taken care of. I'll bug, you know, Jim Hewitt and the other person that works for Victoria.
Yeah, there. Jim is somebody who should be knowledgeable about that
yes,
process.
Yes, Jim is.
I would encourage you, too, to reach out to Eric Eby. You know Eric.
I'll reach out to him, too.
And, you know, obviously this is something we're aware of.
I know.
But it's, you know, it's good that you keep it in the forefront of our minds. Because, it you know, it's... DOT isn't always responsive on things. They're, you know...
I know.
And so things happen... And, you know, we want to make sure that, you know, it's good having you, you know, paying attention to
but
it because
I know,
it's one more voice.
But I also know they'll tag on something onto something that has nothing to do with something else in order to get something done at the DOT. I know they do that.
Mm-hmm.
But one last question is St. Pat's, no prop going in there. It's looking really pretty. But are they going to do something with that bend that goes over when you're coming around the bend after the junkyard? To get into St. Pat's, isn't that supposed to be like straightened or something across from where the Girl Scout is? That is a...
I don't believe the site process. I don't disagree with you. I think
Eric put up, and thank you very much for Eric. He put up a whole bunch of signage on Banfield for
yep.
me. And he also required the workers to put up trucks entering and
yep.
leaving there
yep.
because it's a blind spot right there. But what's going to happen when school starts? Who's going to be responsible to make sure, you know, no one gets hit?
Right. So as follow-up to that, you know, I confirmed with Eric this afternoon, because I knew this question would come up, that we will be following up with, you know, changing traffic patterns as a result of this to make
yep.
sure. And I know the question about straightening the road and reducing the hill in that area was brought up during the review process for the school. And I don't believe it was required as part of the site plan.
That's an ice rink in the winter.
Yeah.
Right at that bend.
It's a challenging corner. So I agree.
That's a worrisome.
Yep.
Okay.
All
right. Peter, who would you go-to to talk to the DOT? I mean, are those local meetings or?
They're usually run out of the state when they get to the, they have their local District 6 folks involved, but usually it's their state design folks.
Okay, all right.
It's on the website, you can see the projects.
Okay.
The Rockingham Bay Commission always has, they have a robust website where it shows different meetings and things in different areas.
It's actually every month. I'm one of the representatives that's actually on the Rockingham Planning Commission.
Awesome.
Yes, so they meet every month, and they have a very good website on what locations are. So.
Thank you.
May I address just a couple comments that were made
by
Kelly? So just a couple things on Banfield Road, and I couldn't agree with you more. Okay, we need more officers. You know, our resources are spread very thin, and I completely agree with you. But just so that you are aware that, and you're part of this, you're part of the city. We have at least one officer dedicated to your part of the city, and sometimes two officers dedicated to your part of the city. So, and we don't, when we respond to calls out to your area or out to what we call Zone 3 for us, which is the west side of town, we're not responding from the station. They're responding within their beat. So they're going to get to you within minutes. So the response times are incredibly quick for the police department. But we will
certainly.
I'm sorry?
We have a lot of homeless.
Oh, we certainly do. But we'll certainly take a look at placement of where the officers are, and we can certainly take a look at that.
Again.
Yep, no problem.
Okay. Thank you. Right here? Can you get the mic?
Yeah, it's for the recording, Roy. Thanks.
My name is Roy Helfer. I live on Middle Road, right across the street from Chase Home. Every time the light on Peverly Hill, is that, when it changes, it depends on the first car. If he's going 40 miles an hour, they all go 40 miles an hour. Is there anybody or who do I talk to about putting a sign up there that says, you're doing over 30 miles an hour, you know, the one they have on where the water tank is?
Mm-hmm.
Because when the cop is sitting there, and he does, he sits in front of our place, or he sits across the street up there, when he gets one of them, they slow down. But every time that light changes, it depends on, and there's always 15 cars coming down that road. It depends on the first car. If he's doing 40 miles an hour, they're all doing 40 miles an hour. They got a crosswalk there because the people from our place go out to walk dogs or go out there or whatever they do. They don't slow down. They don't stop. They just keep going.
So in the inbound traffic?
Yeah.
Coming from Peabody Hill down into town.
So okay. Inbound. Okay.
On
so
Middle Road.
I can answer that. I mean, there's two resources. One is the traffic engineer, Eric Eby, has a number of speed signs. And then I know the police also have some signs as well. So,
I know. They park right there in front of our place, and they get the guys when they're going fast. But every time that light changes, it depends on the first car.
Yep. So we'll get I wrote this down. So we'll get a sign out there. What you'll see is the sign will likely go up, and it won't be turned on. So what happens is they collect the data with it out, and then they're collecting the speed data,
right.
And then they'll turn it on, and then they'll measure the change in speed data. So, okay.
And they're mostly, the first part is an hour timer.
Yep.
That's the speeds.
Okay, I just want to thank you all very much for being here, and I wanted to ask the captain of our police department, how many people did you say there are on staff?
We have 64 sworn officers.
64. And then this is just a question out of interest. Do you have any police dogs?
Like
you? Inquiring minds want to know.
We have two.
Cool.
Axe and Max.
Cool. I once rode around with one of the police officers on a different program, and I was like so impressed with what you do. On the other hand, I'm one of the people who has had a ticket on Banfield Road, so I'm here to tell you, your cops, I'm starting to get to know them all that are in the West End. I don't think you need more of them, personally. They are very effective.
Oh, thank you. Good.
They are everywhere, I swear to God. And then I just wanted to ask Peter from DPW. So I have used Click and Fix, requesting like paving of a side road that I live right on that side road. But I'm just confused about what happens with that, because does that roll into the CIP like next fall, or should I actually submit a proposal to that CIP process that is redundant about that road?
It depends on usually the click and fix is intended for, like, there's a pothole, there's a section of there's a something's broken. Larger expenditures, such as, you know, we want to repave the entire street, yeah, is more of a capital project. So usually the guys will respond to a request like that to say, hey, this is really a capital issue, you know, and point you in the direction of the resident request, the capital resident request.
Okay.
And so that'll then get logged, and we keep track of that. And then every year when we start our capital improvements plan, we go to that log and say, okay, people were requesting these things, and then we draw off that based on the input.
Thank you. And then I wanted to ask Mr. Achilles. To be at code, you have to have these electrically installed, well, I don't even know the right term for it, but it's part of your electrical system, the smoke detectors and carbon monoxide detectors in your house. Yeah, like they're hardwired in. So what keeps happening in my house is, like, it hasn't happened this year, but like last year during one of the big ice storms, like my whole smoke, like my fire system goes off, but it's just because like the electricity went off and then it went on again like very quickly. So I have electricity, but there's no way for me to turn those smoke detectors off, as far as I know. So I just feel like it's a misuse of the fire department that I'm there calling the fire department out when there are like ice storms to come help me try to disconnect that thing. So are there any other alternatives?
Well,
because
you're supposed to have working smoke detectors in your home, and depending on the age of the home, and it sounds like you need to have them.
I do.
But I do want to clarify, we don't mind going out and fixing a problem. I mean, if it was that busy, we would prioritize.
Oh, okay.
So you're not taking away from something else. But daily, I would like to say we go to fires all the time and big emergencies, but a lot of it is just going to help. And if we can't get the right resource, we use public works, we use private contracts, the police department. So don't feel you shouldn't call. And if it's an alarm system that is monitored, you can talk to your monitoring company. But if they're just hardwired in your home, they're going to go off. The good part is we don't always have to come out if it's not transmitted to an alarm company. So if they just go on in your home,
yeah,
we're not going to come out unless you call us. So as long as you don't think there's a problem, but I want to.
You can tell, right? Your ears are like.
Yeah, but I want to reiterate.
There's no question.
When in doubt, you should call us so that we can check it, and we don't mind at all.
Okay, and then my third question is about the sound barriers on I-95, because I'm, you know, very much in support of helping Panaway Manor. Just in terms of quality of life with getting those sound barriers up. And I understand there's a huge history on that, but I don't want it to be lost in the discussions that the other side of I-95 is also worthy of sound barriers, because I'm in neighborhoods back there where sound is increasing and increasing and increasing, and truck traffic is also increasing. And with this proposal to open Borthwick Avenue to Gate Street and to have more trucks go through there, all of that's great in terms of traffic control. I totally understand it, but it keeps increasing noise in our little neighborhoods, also on the other side of I-95, so I'm glad you're here. And then my last comment, it's just a comment, is I understand that Route 1 is a DOT matter, but I'm hoping, I don't know anything about it, I'm hoping that if they do widen it, that they're doing it as a complete street, because that's our vision in our city master plan, and somewhere our master plan has to fit with state resources and state vision, because that's good strategic planning. So I'm hoping that if there is widening, it includes, you know, bike lanes, sidewalks, full lighting, et cetera, to make all those people now expanding in our gateway corridor able to get, you know, to downtown businesses as well. Thank you.
Peter, do you want to talk about sound barriers now, and then we can answer more questions afterwards?
Well, I'll tell you what, let me allow me to ask some other questions of a personal nature, because there are so many topics that we've brought up. And since we're talking about the Beverly Hill Road area, I'm a granddad, so I have two granddaughters, and I often take them to the playground there where the Little League field is. And one of the things that's kind of an irritant is the pedestrian walkway from on Middle Road going over to the other side where the playground is. That's only green for about 3 seconds. And then it starts to blink red, and there's no countdown clock. So going over there with my granddaughters, whether I'm pulling a cart or a baby carriage or something, it's ridiculous. You know, the minute it turns green, I step off and I'm already red. And I don't see how we can teach our children not to go across a red light when the minute they step off the curb, it's already red. And if it was a countdown clock, at least we can say, look, we got 20 seconds to cross over. But no, there's no countdown clock. We don't know when the traffic's going to hit us from left or right. Sometime. So I just want to bring that up as an issue, because I think I'm not the only one that brings children to the playground there. And that's a crosswalk that a lot of people would use.
Sure. That's a great comment. And so we are going through and adding timers on all the pedestrian crosswalk signals as part of our upgrades to our traffic signals. So I'll bring this to Eric Eby and see if what the schedule is on that, and see if make it a higher priority.
Because I know downtown tourists have at least 20 seconds with a countdown clock to get across the street, but up there, you don't know how much time you've got.
Yep.
Anyway.
Yep, and so, it is in the plans to be replacing, you know, to be adding that function to the crosswalks. So it'll get done. Just a matter of, you know, the high volume pedestrian areas are where we start. And it happens to be the downtown, because that's where the majority of the pedestrians are.
But we're the residents, and those are the tourists. Okay.
Yeah,
I'm walking downtown all the time.
Okay. All right.
I mean, it's no different than how we manage roads and stuff like that. So, but your point is well taken.
Yeah. Okay.
And this is a safety concern, because there is more and more children going to that area. So I would think it would warrant, some priority.
Okay, so I want to underscore the Ward 3 area. As the person that represents this area, I keep on telling people that it has the most affordable housing in all of Portsmouth, from north to south, all affordable housing. However, nobody wants to move out because it's a great city to live in. So they're in that house, and it's all affordable, but they're very diverse, as you guys all know. I wanted to ask, I kind of follow up on the Banfield Road thing. The water country issue, has there been any change on that as far as the traffic that you're anticipating this summer for the water country?
I'm not really too concerned. Andrea moved, so it's the folks she has in there now, it's not bothersome to them. So she moved into the Elwin, where it's a lot.
Well, I understand, but I'm thinking about how the traffic is being diverted now.
The traffic isn't diverted. I expect to hear problems over the summer from the new apartment building.
Oh, yeah.
Often that goes on over there and all the traffic. So I'm going to kind of lay low and see what happens in that regard. The traffic is going to be as it was last year. It was just constant, but it's like that every day. Now it's constant, between 7 and 8 o'clock, I can't get out of my driveway. Mm. I have to wait. And I'm on the far, I'm on the Ocean Road between Ocean and Heritage. And I have to wait to get out of my driveway between 7 and 8 in the morning. It's pretty sad. Mm. And between 4:30 and 5 in the afternoon.
Okay, so I have one other question, and that regards to when Eric Eby had that meeting with the Echo Avenue issue. one of the things he mentioned was that the state is planning to reconfigure or redo the traffic circle. And when they do that, the impact will be like, I don't know, 10,000 more cars per day onto Rockingham Avenue, which nobody thinks can actually sustain that much traffic.
So what he was referring to is the Woodbury Avenue bridge.
Yes.
Is going to be replaced. And that's right. Because of the detour routes they were proposing, they would be driving more traffic onto Rockingham Avenue to get them up to Woodbury Avenue. So we're working with the state to come up with a solution to you know, force the traffic back up from the traffic circle itself instead of getting them up there. But as you know, Rockingham gets a lot of use.
It's the most busy road there.
It's a slipstream, yeah, and it's you know, it's not a good use of that kind of road,
right?
Because it's not a great merge.
I think Eric said that they have like 4,500 per
yep.
day on that road.
Yeah, it's a very high traffic.
With that bridge, they would be expecting another 10,000 per day on the same road.
You know, it's hard to say whether that'll play out that way. You know, people will want to avoid the area because of the construction. So you may see a reduction in traffic. More people may be going down Maplewood Avenue. And alternative routes, you know, Market Street. Mm-hmm. So it's, you know, it's hard to say sometimes until right. the actual impact happens,
yeah.
you don't know what
you
what the true change will be. You know, obviously, you know, we're very concerned about that and we've brought that to DOT's attention. So we'll be keeping a real close eye on that.
Okay, I wanted to also ask Fire Chief Achilles about his two boats.
My two boats. They're not my boats.
I understand.
No.
But I just wanted you to have an opportunity to explain why you need those boats, whereas it seemed like maybe a year ago or something, you guys gave that boat away that you had. You said you didn't need it or it was unnecessary. It was the wrong type of boat, whatever. But now you want two boats. So could you just explain that?
Sure. And we did a presentation to the council tonight also just to, right after 9/11, there was a strong desire in the Piscataqua River Basin to have a fireboat for terrorism, to the Coast Guard and the shipyard were gonna change their mission a lot, tighten it up quite a bit. So the thought was with the LP tankers in the river, the oil, that we needed a fireboat. Something you see in New York, Portland, Boston, that concept. And some numbers are thrown around about $1 million or so dollars for a boat. Homeland Security, we were able to secure one for $350,000, which I was a strong proponent at the time based on the environment we were living in and some of that post 9/11 concern of terrorism and large fires in ports. Over the course of the time, we found that nothing's free, that we were spending about $15,000 to $20,000 a year just in maintenance costs at the expense of other operations within the department. It didn't mean we didn't need a boat. We have some responsibility to protect our shores and up the river and up Sagamore Creek, Little Harbor, and so forth. After we did our study, we realized that there was one gap that we didn't have a resource to get in the mill ponds. Which if somebody went in the mill pond, a child, a kayaker, we had no way to get in there. So we're trying to think of what could we get, like a Zodiac or something smaller. Also, could we get another boat that was more versatile but less expensive so we could operate on the Piscataqua? Now, because it was a grant, you cannot sell the boat. You cannot sell a grant boat. And there was a department on Lake Winnipesaukee that was seeking a boat and a grant, and we thought it would be great to transfer the boat to them because they wouldn't have to outlay the money. We got the boat through a grant and we can't sell it. And as I said, the council, there was a decision by the council at the time to work with Newcastle and transfer the boat to Newcastle, not there. So back in 2015 and 16, we had been talking about a two boat model. Less expensive to operate, more reliable, more predictable, and we wouldn't have to dedicate so many people to the boat to operate. So it wasn't really, the best thing to say is we didn't need that boat, the 33-foot boat, but we needed capabilities to get into our water. And we failed years ago to identify the mill ponds as our, you know, we had to get in. Up at near Bratskeller in the Sagamore Creek, we couldn't get the larger boat up there, so that's why we looked at that model. And it went through two capital processes. So when this came up, and I'll be honest, I was a little taken back because I'm thinking we tried to explain this. It was in our capital plan. It was in our strategic plan. And it just seemed that when this came up again, a number of people didn't understand or didn't go backwards and say, oh, I remember this. And even today in the paper, there was a letter to the editor, which was I have like 18 articles on this over the years that kind of explained where we're heading. They misrepresented. They thought we have a $250,000 boat now that we're not using. That's not true. We have a $20,000 boat and trailer that we can deploy right now. And I'd love to say we're doing hundreds of calls with it, but that would not be a good thing because that means something else is happening in the city that's not good. But we have the capabilities right now to go to a lot of areas. I'll end it with, we think we're on the right track. We had the Coast Guard support and they understood, and our other stakeholders in the river. Again, I said the council understood where we're headed. I don't want to be the fire chief the day we're watching from the shore along Bow Street or near Pierce Island, because Coast Guard has a responsibility other places and we can't get to the problem. Right. And I think this is a financially appropriate program that's sustainable and won't tax our budget and the taxpayer, my taxes, as the larger boat was going to do.
Okay. Well, thank you very much. And I don't want to seem like I'm stalling about the noise abatement, but so let me talk about that. We have, Laura Pantelakis and I have been constantly pushing the DOT and various bills in the legislature about this issue. Our city right now is in the process of qualifying for what they call Type 2 noise abatements, which is a new category that the state did not qualify for a year ago. And I think because of our prodding, they made themselves available for that. And the problem was that anything that was not, that when there was no Type 2 abatement, that meant that once a project was built, if noise abatement wasn't part of the project, you couldn't get it after the fact. And Type 2 allows noise mitigation to happen after the fact. So we are now in that queue of Type 2 a noise abatement. And we are, however, funding is always the issue in New Hampshire. They like to pass things and then they don't fund anything, you know. So one of the requirements for Type 2 actually is that the city or the municipality put up, I think, 20%, maybe is that 20%, is that correct, of the funding for the mitigation. And that's to prevent towns and municipalities who don't want to contribute anything from asking for it, but then not contributing towards it. And I think that's just a way for them to abrogate their responsibility and ask at least some money from the local municipality. So we have been doing various things in Concord, including we invited Governor Sununu to come and visit the Panaway neighborhood, actually at the home of one of the woman who lives the closest to Panaway neighborhood. And we hope to have a conversation with him, hope to have a conversation with him in her house to say, okay, let's see if we can hear each other and see what her backyard looks like. Unfortunately, he was not available to come, but we do have a visit set up by one of his special assistants next Tuesday at the Panaway neighborhood. I have five Panaway neighborhood residents who have invited him to come on behalf of these residents. So we have five residents of the neighborhood, and we have Executive Councilor Russell Prescott who wanted to be there. as well as the media and so forth. So we're going to show him what it looks like to live there and hear the noise every single day and hear from the local residents there what it means for them. And I don't know what will happen as a result of that, but we're trying to keep it on a high profile. Also, there was a bill that was just turned down by the legislature this past week, which where neighbors in Bedford were complaining of noise abatement needs in Route 93 area recently. And so they were pushing for a study committee to look at type 2 noise abatements. The committee that heard that bill voted, I think, 20-1, I think, to ignore it, which in Concord means we don't have the money. That's the way it goes. And I pulled it off the consent calendar and spoke about it and mentioned again that we agree with Bedford. They need noise abatement and we need noise abatement, but we're about 30 years ahead of them on that queue. So let's talk about it. So we're trying to get a high profile on this issue in general. And I think our Portsmouth Herald is doing a good job in keeping that issue alive. And I will certainly work with you, too, and contact you about your area, because it's true that it's not just one side of that roadway that's creating this noise. And as Peter Rice mentioned before, the state wants us to say, okay, we're going to have zoning ordinances that preclude anyone from moving into those zones that need mitigation in the future. So once they do it, they hope to do it forever for that area and those residents, and not allow people to move back in, which makes sense, right?
Sure. It's actually, just to clarify that, it's yeah. It's not necessarily move, it's to build new homes, within that
okay.
area.
Yeah, that's what you're yeah. right, absolutely. So, sure, yeah, go ahead.
So I understand about the local money would be not a match, but it would be there. But when you talk about state funds, aren't there also federal funds coming into the DOT?
Yes.
And that, so there's some combination of state and federal that should be available for budgeting for these sound barriers. I don't understand how it never becomes a priority.
Well, it's a mysterious process because you're absolutely right. There's federal money coming in. But in reality, what must have happened back in 1973, when the first 95 area two-lane highway was built, the federal law was already in place to provide for noise abatement. And at that point, they may have
received the funding for it. They may just not have
built it. I don't know. I mean, you know, trying to
go back and find who's responsible for it and where the money is, it, I think a few less effort, because there's not going to be any money anyway. You know, they've spent it for some other reason. So there is federal money there.
And there should be some way of identifying that, but I doubt that that's a very productive way of going. The other problem is that any funding, and this is, if you look at the kind of funding for roadways that is available in the state, you've got the tolls, you've got gas tax, and then you've got the equivalent money coming from outside for projects that were approved as a federal project. Now, this is a federal highway. This is an interstate roadway, so it should be a federal jurisdiction issue, but the state is not willing to get involved apparently in trying to get any more money, because they probably got money before in 1972 or so. So unless they raise the tolls, unless they raise gas tax and say we're going to take some of that gas tax and use it for type 2 abatement. And that's what they got to do. They got to identify funding for type 2 projects. And I'm going to actually follow up with the representatives from Bedford to say, let's put in a bill to see if we can find funding for your neighborhood and our neighborhood. Anyway, so thanks.
So like I said, I'm on the Rockingham Planning Commission, so it's something new to me, but at the last meeting, they actually adopted a plan, and Peter would be able to speak. Something I've never heard of before, it was called TIP. So TIP is a subsidiary of New Hampshire DOT, and there's more funding. Actually, Portsmouth just was awarded on that TIP list
for a multi-use path that will take place on
Elwin.
On Elwin Road. So I don't know, maybe if Pia could speak to that, and have you ever looked into TIP or ever heard of it?
Yeah, so we have put in requests for sound barriers in that program, and what it comes down to is we don't qualify until we have our ordinances in place. So we're in the process of getting that done right now, and we've been working closely with DOT to make sure we can access any available funds. Recently, if you recall, there was an effort by DOT to raise the tolls. They were going to have a set aside to fund Type 2 projects in that raise, in raising that. But that was
Councilor Prescott was very supportive of that.
Yep, yep. So I mean that was.
Yeah. So that is a program that we might be able to go after for some of the funding for some.
Yeah,
is it state or federal funding? Is it state?
It's federal.
It's federal.
Yeah. It's all
federal. It was really interesting. It was a very interesting meeting to see all the lists of all of New Hampshire and how they go. But I don't think a lot of people are aware of TIP. So.
Well, each community puts in, you know, their requests into that, and we work with the Rockingham Planning Group to do that. So yes, we are aware that we are. And it has gone. It is going through. So
I just wanted to know.
Yeah, we got to access it.
I've never heard of it, and I don't think most residents have. So.
Yep.
Okay.
Oh.
My turn.
Yep. Go ahead.
Ralph DiBonato. Linda and I live on Upper Islington Street. Just an informational piece, as quick as I can get it out. Michael Kane, Borthwick Forest Development, the 40 acres between Upper Islington Street and Borthwick Avenue. That project starts Monday morning at 8 a.m. at a pre-construction meeting that the developer has called. I believe he's called that meeting because he was chastised by the planning board when he made his application for his project for never having met with the neighborhood on his development. That meeting's at 8 a.m. on Monday at Portwalk Place, Linda?
Yes.
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 At Portwalk Place, and I think it's there because his developer
Procon
is involved with Portwalk Place. Peter, are you going to be there? Someone from the city, according to the
somebody. Numbers? Yeah, somebody from the city will be there.
Juliet's going to be there.
Juliet, but usually somebody from my staff is there.
Yeah,
I'm out of the office Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday next week.
So representative, Peter.
A representative will be there. Typically, it's Dave DeFosis, but I think Dave's indisposed that day. So
my point is that it's just something for the neighborhood to be watching. Linda and I have missed maybe two meetings in 10 years on that property, and the only reason Michael Kane hasn't developed it till now because he would never concede his wish to put a road from Borthwick Avenue to Islington Street where the old radio station road came out right on the bad corner. It's the one thing he would never give up in all his attempts to develop, and he's been held off for 10 years. The proposal, this is the first of his development of the 40 acres. He's going to put up another one of his office buildings similar to the one that's the medical building between National Sea and Liberty Mutual. It's identical, really. He's going to have an access road from Borthwick Avenue opposite the last entrance into the hospital if you're coming from Greenland Road, making a crossroads. He's got an easement through the Jackson Gray parking lot. He's going to cross the B&M railroad track with a grade crossing and end this at a cul-de-sac. But he did get the planning board to agree that he could put a 10-foot wide road in from the end of the cul-de-sac to Islington Street that would be gated and closed at all times there only for emergency. And it was pretty hard to deny because with the railroad and the Pan Am what they are, there's no reason to believe that a train might not break down on that grade crossing and have no emergency access to this office building. So my warning is keep an eye on this project for the neighborhood. But
can you just say where we go?
Oh, okay. What's the name of the street?
Portwalk Place.
Portwalk Place. Okay. If you enter it from Hanover Street, it is
you have to go up. You have to go down.
Halfway down the street on the right, it's the entrance into a conference room in that hotel. It's you go down Portwalk Place past the British Beer Pub, and I think it's the next door.
I think it's the Portsmouth Event Center or something like that.
Is that the Event Center?
Okay, Harbor Events.
Harbor Events, yeah.
8 a.m. Monday morning. Notices went out to abutters. It's not a city function.
Nope.
It is a, it's a contractor's function. But the city chose to be represented to hear. Peter, the city has to has some say as to how he can construct his project, right? Because at the planning board, he agreed not to build it out from Islington Street, that he would do his construction from Borthwick Avenue.
Yeah, and we go through a process which is called the Construction Management and Mitigation Plan.
Thank you.
And as part of that, we require he held a public meeting, which is why you received that information. So that was because of the process we go through. We forced them to do that. It's a pre-construction meeting. So before they start, although they have done some work out there by doing some demolition on one of the adjacent buildings. So we are aware of this project, and they, you know, they continue to want to access off of Islington, and that's been a non-starter from a construction standpoint. And we forced them to actually accelerate their railroad crossing access from the gray building side.
We appreciate it. Final comment. For anyone who wasn't aware of this, or if this is new to them, you have to think about what the traffic would be on that road. As an example, when Liberty Mutual got out at 5 o'clock on Friday and 1,000 people wanted to go to a downtown restaurant, it would be the most direct route. It would become a cut through of momentous proportion. Mm-hmm. And that's why we've opposed it all these years, because we're a residential neighborhood and he wanted to connect us to a business neighborhood.
Question, which is really a question I think of Cliff, which is whoever the guy is who is the facilitator or moderator or whatever for Next Door Neighbor, is it appropriate to be able to notify through Next Door Neighbor that that meeting is occurring so that people even know? Because I mean, like, there's what, 12 of us here? How do people get to know about that meeting? And who is that guy? How do you contact him? I'd like to contact him.
Sure. So I don't think there is a guy for Next Door.
Yeah. Each neighborhood has a lead.
I think they call it.
Yeah. And it's
lead.
The person that started it in that neighborhood by sending out the invitations.
Yeah. And it doesn't have to be that person that would post something. So anyone who's on nextdoor.com, and if you're not already, we would encourage people to. So it's free, it's easy. You log into nextdoor.com, put in your name and your address, and if there's a neighborhood group already, then you'll be part of it. And they vet that people are residents of the neighborhood. That's one of the big things that we really like about it. It's free, there's not too much noise, and you know, like Facebook's a lot noisier and busier. Nextdoor is pretty calm. It's good for, you know, recommendations on plumbers and carpenters and lost pets or things. But it's good for neighborhood things like this. And so if you're on there, anyone that's on there can post something to their neighborhood or their adjoining neighborhoods. So we're working on trying to get something so the neighborhood committee or even the city can post things to all of the neighborhoods.
Because right now, when you post, it goes to the neighborhoods you touch, right. I think.
Yeah.
And maybe
like
a little
this
bit
event,
more.
I posted this event.
Yeah, and then I posted it, too, to get to other neighborhoods. Yeah. But if you post it, it will go to your neighborhood, so.
I have a follow-up to the Banfield thing when Peter asked about the traffic, mm-hmm. and it just recollected me on it. We had, and I just remembered this, we had major traffic issues last summer. I'm sure you guys don't have control over it, but we were gridlocked almost every weekend, the Water Country, of course, but people coming off of Ocean from Stratum, Route 1, because everyone with that new Wave app or whatever it's called, I don't do the fancy
Waze,
stuff.
Right.
They all got, you know, told to, because of the Route 1 tolls, to go around it.
Mm-hmm.
So they went around it. But they ended up getting stuck right back at the bridges again. So they were getting stuck. But it was mostly New York, New Jersey, Connecticut, New York, New Jersey, Connecticut. It was nonstop on Banfield Road. Couldn't get out Route 1. Couldn't get out Banfield. People were lost. And on 33, it was like
a Stratum Fair just, you know, so if you're coming home from 101 on 33 to get to my house, you were stuck in nonstop traffic. Mm-hmm. And it wasn't because of the beach traffic or anything, it was because of that new Waves app. But that's out of our control.
Right. Well, first of all, before I answer that question, I just wanted you folks to know that Chief Myrna could not make it here tonight. He's on vacation, so I'm here on his behalf.
Lucky
so
you.
Just to mention that. I know exactly what you're talking about. I couldn't even get out of the police department,
right,
let alone be out on Banfield Road. So, right, so there was a lot of factors. There was one particular weekend in particular, which I think was the July 4th weekend.
July 4th weekend.
So we're talking, you know, it was almost like
Duncan,
a five-day
Duncan's
weekend.
Duncan's Ave, Marcy Street, yeah. All gridlock.
It was a
95 State
correct.
Street.
So basically it kind of started there and pushed its way out through the entire city.
And then they got stuck again.
Exactly. So, you know, you had a five-day weekend, you had a holiday, beautiful weather, we have a major bridge closed, and it was a perfect recipe, a perfect storm for this type of gridlock. And to be quite honest with you, Kelly, there was nothing anybody could have done about that one. Nothing.
That thing is still going to exist. So
well, I'm not quite sure. I'm thinking now that the middle bridge is back open, I think that may alleviate some of this issue. But I know in the past when we've had issues, Peter, I think we've spoken to Google Maps, and we've spoken to other.
Yeah, we reached out to Google Maps and the various wayfinding folks and try to clarify.
Cut through because you're going to get stuck anyway.
Well, it's a public road.
Yeah.
You know, so it's you know legally there, people are allowed to travel the roads.
True.
Yeah.
So if I could real quick, as far as with Ralph, I'm in that same vicinity. Ralph knows that, more or less, for the public information. So when I've been to as many meetings as you have, I mean, and maybe missed maybe as many as you have, but the Kane project did not get the fire access that was denied. The gate is out. The approval that was a 10-foot multi-path was the only thing that was going to go through there. There is no road, no access. I'm not saying anything would change, but the final approvals, as everything got through, the fire department even went and talked about it, and it was something that was never asked for. And when the residents and everyone came and spoke up, it was something that actually got turned down at the planning board. And then, unless something had changed from TAC or something like that, it was a multi-purpose path for bicycles and pedestrians only. There would never be a connector from Borthwick onto Islington.
10-foot wide, no gates, and that will ensure that nobody will.
That I don't know. I think they talked about putting some kind of diverter or something.
It'll have something that restricts
correct.
Vehicles.
I agree.
Okay. Any other questions?
I just have a quick follow-up question about the ordinance changes regarding the noise abatement. What's the status of those? When do you expect those to proceed?
We have a draft from our former city planner. Planning director,
yep.
Rick Tainter, was hired as a consultant to put a draft together, or to put together, work with us on that. So we have a draft we're reviewing right now, and I think it's near complete as far as I know. Maybe Nancy, if...
Yeah, I don't know anything more. Yeah. But I know that there is a draft available.
Okay.
Yep. So I mean, it's moving forward. It is a high priority because, you know, this is something that and it's the entire 95 corridor that we're really interested in.
Okay. And then just one other informational comment for everyone that's here. In about a month and a half, the city is going to be hosting a community meeting regarding the Coakley landfill. The meeting is going to be actually here at Community Campus and the larger in the gymnasium. So that is Thursday, June 7th, 7 p.m., open to the public. We'll be inviting the representatives from the EPA and the DES from the state of New Hampshire, Coakley Landfill Group. And then we're inviting all the select boards from the surrounding towns, Hampton, Northampton, Newington, Greenland, Newcastle, Rye, Portsmouth, and all of the state legislators from the area. So it won't be televised, but we are going to record it for YouTube, so it would be available on online after. And then the city put up a fairly extensive website that's getting more extensive. So if you go to cityofportsmouth.com and put in the word Coakley, there is a page with a lot of information on it, including now there's a form. So if you're not able to attend that meeting or you want to get a question answered for that meeting, you could submit it online at that site and the website, and then that'll be included with the moderators for the night. Okay.
Okay. All right. I want to thank everybody for coming, especially our panel. Thank you very much for taking the time to come out, and it's been very informative. And our next community forum meeting will be June 20th. That's what it is. Yeah. And we'll keep everybody informed. But thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
June 20th. Let me see.